Yes, so my name is Beth. Like Louise was saying there, please feel free to pop any messages in the chat. I've got it open just so I can have a quick look at when questions are popping up as well, so that we can talk about them at the end. Now, this presentation is going to talk to you about the next steps after applying for university, obviously through UCAS. So it is going to be quite extensive. We are going to cover a few different topics throughout this. So with that, I'm just going to sort of go over a little bit of the key information that will be relevant to you guys as you look after your application. So we offer 6 different types of accommodation. They are either, well, 2 of them are actually on our campus, and then the other 4 are within a 10-minute walk. At most, I would say a 15-minute walk if you get stuck at some of the traffic light crossings, because there are some. So they're all very close to campus. And then our actual campus is only a 15-minute walk from the high street or a 20-minute walk from the train station. And that train station is one of the particularly well-connected ones, with direct routes down to London as well. So it's a really, really good placement in terms of where we are in the city. For those of you who don't know necessarily about Lincoln as a city itself, we have a lovely historic cathedral and castle at the top of our hill in our Balegate area. Our castle is nearly 1,000 years old, actually, and holds one of the remaining 4 Magna Cartas as well. So we have great links to actual national history. And the cathedral is absolutely stunning as well. Throughout the city's sort of calendar, we have lots of different events that go on, sometimes in the historic quarter at the top of the hill, sometimes on the high street. So there's always something interesting going on in Lincoln. And the Red Arrow is actually based nearby, so obviously the National Red Arrows. It's always quite nice to see them flying over the city every now and then too. As a university, we have over 150 different sports and society opportunities for you guys to get involved with when you're with us. So that's a really, really great way to make friends, try out new hobbies, and sort of get to know different people in different environments as well. So we have lots of different opportunities, including financial support as well. So we have scholarships and bursaries that are available for different students and different circumstances. And if you're ever interested in a detailed list of which ones those are for, how to apply for them, whether you're eligible, we have a bursary and scholarship page on our website that you can have a look at. Now, we're going to cover a little bit of just a summary of the timeline, talking about different decisions and explaining a bit about what UCAS Extra is. I'm going to talk to you about the offer holder days, which would be really, really good for you guys to come and see us, and brush over a little bit of student finance just to give you some key deadlines and information that you need, and talk a bit about getting ahead and what you can actually do to prepare yourselves for university. Now, this is an activity that obviously I would normally have you guys maybe do in person. However, I just want you to take a couple minutes to think about all of the different things you might need for university and how many of you might think you all need a toaster. Now, I say that because a lot of people bring a full list of everything: 1 kettle, 1 toaster, several pots, pans. And then when everyone gets to university, they've all thought of the same thing. So then you've got 4 or 5 toasters at university in 1 flat, and you don't always need 4 or 5 toasters, unless something's going tragically wrong, that is. So having a think about what you might need to buy in advance of university is really, really important. And then when you're getting to your accommodation, seeing if there's anything that you do then need to buy when you're there. So if obviously no one has then thought, well, actually, I don't want to be the person bringing the 4th toaster into the flat, you might find that when you get there, you then need to buy a toaster. And you could always do that as a new flatmate activity as well. So having a think about what you need for university is really, really important. Now, your journey to come, obviously, we're talking past applications at this point. So you're looking at things like student finance at the moment. And I will, like I say, I will go into that and explain it a little bit for you guys. But the main deadline is the 19th of May this year, I believe. And that is the date for application. And I will get into why that's really, really important to remember this date as well. You also need to look at applying for accommodation during this time, checking out your different options, working out which is going to be within your budget, whether there's anything particular that you're after, like say you want your own ensuite bathroom, or if you're not that bothered about an ensuite bathroom, having a look at the different options out there. And then having a look at seeing what you can do over the summer period while you're waiting for your results day in August. have a look at maybe doing the grocery shopping around the house, something to give you an idea of budgeting for that independent lifestyle and how that might work for you. Could be really a fun activity and also quite good at preparing yourselves. Now, there are some courses that require interview, so having a look at different interview techniques is really important. So start practicing questions. A lot of the time, if a course is one that's known for interviewing, for example, obviously something like in the healthcare sector, maybe medicine or midwifery, paramedic science, there is going to be different resources out there that can help you train for those entry tests, those interviews that you need to prepare for. Remember that the questions are for you. There are questions, sorry, for you to ask the interview panel. Of course, an interview is something that a lot of people might necessarily think is one-sided. However, that's not necessarily the case. It's your time to find out about the course as well. It's not just whether we think you're going to be a right fit for the course. You've also got to check if we're a right fit for you. And with interview, you have to consider things like travel time. So obviously, if your interview is later in the afternoon, you're obviously going to set off a little bit later. So make sure you just give yourself plenty of time to get there. We are in a city centre, so sometimes at peak times, traffic can be quite heavy. So that would just be something to think about as well. There we go. Now, when it comes to UCAS and you're making your decision, a lot of the students in here will probably know exactly what I'm talking about when I say a conditional offer versus an unconditional offer. However, for those who don't, I am just going to explain the difference. So a conditional offer is exactly what it sounds like. There are certain conditions that you have to meet to, that could be entry requirements. It might be things like certain points on the MCAT or anything like this. So it will be a condition that will be clearly stated when we have made your offer. So for example, if we have stated that you need 2 Bs and an A for this course, we will make it clear what the offer is and what the condition is. And on the flip side of that, an unconditional offer is exactly what it sounds like. So an unconditional offer means we have no conditions for you. We have a place for you. And if you would like it, you can accept it now and then come to us in the autumn. And a rejection is unfortunately exactly what it sounds like too. Now that means you have obviously not been offered a place on our course. And interestingly, you can't actually respond to any offers until every institution that you've applied to, so every university, has given you an offer. And then at that point is when you can apply. So if you're still waiting on a few offers, don't worry. Some may come in quicker than others. Keep an eye on your UCAS. It's really important to check back regularly as well. And it's also a great chance to then go out to these offer holder days that I'll cover a little bit later and help you make your decisions too. Now, this is UCAS Extra. So most people, if not all, will use the 5 choices on your original application, and you have to have used all of these before you can then go into UCAS Extra. UCAS Extra means you can add another course if you want to. So this opens, well, obviously has opened this year on the 23rd of February. And this is when you are not holding any offers. So if you have not received, or if you have rejected offers from universities and you have no offers that you are holding, so no conditionals, no unconditionals, you can then go through UCAS Extra. You can only apply for one course at a time. So if you have maybe been rejected from your university choices, or if you have rejected their offers and you want to go through UCAS Extra, you can apply to, let's say, history at the University of Lincoln. You can only apply to that one, and then you have to wait 21 days to hear back from us in this case. And then if that were to not go ahead, or if you were to reject that one, you can then go again. However, this is how it works. You can only do one course at a time. You cannot apply to multiple institutions through UCAS Extra. And if you accept the offer through UCAS Extra, it becomes automatically your firm choice. That's your first choice, should I say. Now, offer holder days are a really great example to see our university campus. For those of you who have not already seen, here are some lovely pictures. So as you will see in one of the larger pictures at the top with some lovely brick buildings, that is one of our accommodations called St. Mark's. That is a 10-minute walk from campus, and it is one of the newer, I think it is actually the newest accommodation that we've got. It's lovely, made up of a variety of ensuite bedrooms with flats of, I think, about 10 bedrooms. They can vary in size, though, flats, depending on the shape of the building, size of the rooms and the flats and that kind of thing. So there will be different levels of sizes of flats. Next to it is actually a picture of our university lecture theatre called the Isaac Newton Building. So this is our INB lecture theatre, as we like to call it. It holds around about 550 people, give or take a few people. And that is where a lot of our talks actually go on during our offer holder days as well. So when you actually come to an offer holder day, what happens is you'll receive, firstly, and most importantly, if you ask me, a tea or coffee voucher. And that is a great way to start your day. And then you get to get a timetable for your subject choice. So students, you will be given a timetable with a variety of different talks about your subject. Parents, carers, companies, you guys can also get a timetable. And this is targeted to you and helping you understand everything you need to know about the process and also how to support your student going through it. We appreciate that it can be quite complex and complicated, and we appreciate it can also be slightly overwhelming if you don't know much about the UCAS process. So these talks are great examples to learn about things like clearing or accommodation. There are student society talks as well by the SU who can talk about all of the different things that we do to support students on campus. So these days are not only just for our students who are coming to us, but also our students' parents, carers and family members who are coming to support them. Now, firm and insurance choice. This is, again, something in the UCAS portal that some of you guys might know what I'm on about. But just to clear up anything that might be slightly confusing about it, a firm choice is your first choice, essentially. This is the university that you want to go to. So if you were offered two different choices and you firmed one, that is the one you want to go to primarily. And then an insurance choice is also what it sounds like. It's essentially a backup choice. So it might be decided based on maybe you preferred one accommodation over the other. It might be that the course was more interesting at this one than at that one. It could be any variety of reasons. Why people choose to firm and insure choices is a very unique process, and everyone has different ways of going about it. So just make sure that when you are making this decision and choosing a firm and choosing an insurance, that you are doing it with the decision fully informed with everything that you've had a look at that's important to you. The only reason I say this is because if you were to, say, insure the one that you actually wanted to put as a firm and you got them the wrong way around, although it is reversible sometimes, it's not always guaranteed. It's not always guaranteed, and essentially sometimes UCAS can't always reverse this. So if something was to happen with it a few minutes and you think, oh no, I've just clicked the wrong one, you can ring UCAS and try to get through to them as quickly as possible. But like I said, it's not always guaranteed. So this is just something to bear in mind, that it is a very busy system, especially the same time of year as everybody else is making those decisions. Now, if you reject your first choice on results day, you will have to re-enter through clearing. And clearing is, it's one of those ones, it's kind of similar to UCAS extra in the sense that it's a variety of courses. And essentially what clearing is you can go through it after results day, and any spaces that universities have on different courses, you can find them there. Now, because of the way that it works, obviously universities have made their offers, some courses will be full and will never make it to clearing. And that's usually ones that are very, very popular and have a smaller class size. So that could be something like paramedic science or midwifery. So if you're entering a course that you know is particularly competitive, just consider that it might not appear at clearing. And some universities might not go to clearing at all. If they don't have any spaces, they won't go to clearing. So this is just something to bear in mind when you're rejecting choices, that we, with clearing, you can't always guarantee that you'll get the university that you want or the course that you want. Now, at this point, this is just a chance if anybody wanted to write their questions in the chat just before they forget. And then we're going to actually move on onto a few different things here. So this is a timeline for student finance. It's obviously, it's very sort of simplified just to help you out a little bit in the actual larger process. Now, you register and complete online as soon as you can. There are two different types of loans that you will go through. There's a tuition fee loan that is not means tested. The tuition fee loan essentially pays for obviously your tuition, so your teaching hours, your coursework being taught to you, your lectures, your seminars, your tutorial periods. But it also pays for things like the equipment that you use to be maintained, or to obviously buy new stuff, to maintain the buildings and the laboratories that you might be working in. So your tuition fee actually covers a lot of things that you would benefit from at the university. Maintenance loans are where things can be a little bit variable from person to person in a unique situation, because that is means tested. What means tested is essentially the government will use the joint income of your household to judge how much money you qualify for. Now, this money is your personal money. So if you imagine it as your savings account, that is what a maintenance loan is. It pays for your accommodation. It could pay for your parking. If you get a car and you want to bring it to the city, you may have to pay for parking in the city because we have no parking on campus. It could be that you pay for trains if you can't drive. So, for example, I could not drive when I went to university many, many moons ago. So I would take the train home and my maintenance loan paid for my train tickets. A maintenance loan is essentially you can spend it on anything you need to live. So groceries, going to the gym, joining a society, going to the cinema, having a day out, shopping with your friends. There is no specific requirement for how you use a maintenance loan, whereas obviously a tuition fee goes directly to the university and they will only ever pay you as much as you need for your course. So you don't ever have to worry about not affording your tuition fees for the year. The government will always give you enough. Now, when you apply, it's really important that you have an accessible bank account that you can work from. So don't pop a bank detail down, and if you can't get into that bank account and you haven't for 6 months because you don't have the password, it needs to be a bank account that you can access. Same for when you're applying using an email address. Please don't use an email address that you haven't got into since you were 12, because there is no way that you'll get into it now, and that's where all of your updates will go. So it's really, really important that you keep track of it. And when you're applying as well, just make sure that every information that you're putting in is correct. Everything from your email address to your actual address, the university that you're applying to. So always use your firm choice. So obviously, for example, if we were your firm choice, it would be really important that you put us, because that's obviously where you want to go. It is easier to change the university of your choice when on your application when it's already in than to apply late, because if you miss the deadline, unfortunately that is a guarantee that you will not necessarily get your money by September, and obviously you need your money in September. Now that is a really important thing to focus on. Something about, I think it was about 50% of people last year didn't make the deadline. It was a really high statistic and it worried me slightly. So please make sure you make that deadline. You can always change your mind about the university that you put in your application at a later date. And then something important that not a lot of people know about is that your maintenance loan, that is split up into three. So you will see a total sum of how much you're awarded each year. So let's say you are awarded £7,000 a year. That will be split up over three installments throughout the year. So that is something you'll have to think about when you're budgeting, again, for accommodation, lifestyle. And you have to apply each year. It doesn't roll over. So if you're doing a three-year degree, you will have to apply for each of those 3 years. Same for a four or a five-year degree and so on. So it's really important that you keep track of all of your passwords and emails that you use for this as well, because obviously you'll have to apply each year. Now, there are a variety of additional funding. So obviously I've mentioned that we have 12 different bursaries and scholarships. So they are for a variety of different categories of people, and you can apply for them. Some of them you don't have to apply for. And if you want to go on our website and have a look, we actually break down which ones you could be automatically enrolled into, which ones you have to apply for, what they're awarded for, how to know if you're eligible, all of these things. So it's worth having a look if you think you could qualify for one of those. Please go and have a look. An extra bit of financial support always helps. Now, we do obviously work, you've got the student finance, which is the main source of funding for a lot of people. But there are other courses like nursing and midwifery that also benefit from some extra funding. So again, just have a look and see if your course is one of those ones that's actually supported with extra funding. That might be something like a long course loan, where obviously some courses are longer than others, so they require extra financial support. So it's really important to have a look at a variety of different options out there, especially if you think you might be eligible. Now, when you're applying for accommodation, Now, when you're applying for accommodation, we will advise you when new applications open. You may need your firm or insurance choice, obviously. So if you know you want to go to University A, of course, you're going to have a look at accommodation for them first. When it comes to different accommodations, you need to consider, obviously, what are your options? Have you come and had a look around where you want to live? It's really important that you like where you're going to live for at least 1 year of your university experience. So you're also going to want to make sure that it's one of those ones where you know how much you need to deposit as well, and do you have the funds for that? If not, you need to then obviously think about how you're going to get those for the application deadline. And some accommodations are more popular. So one of our most popular ones is something called Signet Wharf. It's actually the one of those tower blocks there that you can see. I think it's the grey one in that picture. And Signet Wharf is one of the most popular ones. It's one of the ones that fills up the quickest. So if you know that you're one of the ones you want is a popular one, make sure you're on it when it becomes time to apply. If you're late in applying, don't worry. We do have a variety of different accommodation options and lots of space. If you're ever concerned when you're looking at the accommodation process, or if you're ever unsure, please just give us a ring. Give us an email as well. We have lots of places that you can contact on the website. And we also do live lounges as well. So live lounges are exactly what they sound like, a bit like this kind of situation and setup. And they are themed around different things. So we usually have one accommodation live lounge, and we might have another one on something else. And you can find those on our website about when they are and what they're on next, so that you can see and speak to the people who are the experts in all things university applications, deadlines, accommodations, all of these variety of things. If you're home, if you're not sure if you want to stay at home, if you want to move away, always, always still apply. It's always easier to withdraw an application than it is to start a new one late and maybe not get the accommodation that you wanted. Generally, the rule of thumb for student finance and universities and accommodation, all of these things, is to apply. And then if you were to change your mind, it's so much easier to just reject or withdraw that application than it is to put one in late. So that would be my biggest sort of piece of takeaway as well for you. Now, we are going to talk a little bit about the transition and well-being and getting ahead as well. I'm not sure if I'm completely honest this video will work, but I will try and we can see. I say that just because I'm on a tablet, so we'll have a look. No, okay, I apologize that this video doesn't want to work. What I will do is I will send this presentation over so that your lovely, lovely tutors can disperse it and you can see the video for yourselves as well. Okay, now budgeting. The university maintenance loan is a finite pot of money. That means that you only have so much per three instalments. Obviously, a lot of people tend to go and get part-time jobs at university. We have a variety of different campus jobs that you can get involved in. For example, my team, so obviously we speak to a lot of people. We have students who help out at events on campus, but also off campus as well. So they will go out to schools for us as part of the recruitment team. And that's a good paying job as well. So there are lots of different on-campus jobs. And obviously we are right next to the city centre. So there are lots of jobs in hospitality or retail that are available to you as an option if that was something you wanted to look at. You need to start having a think about things like monthly spend as well. So parents, I'm sure you'll understand exactly what I'm talking about when I say you've got to factor in your commute. So if you're getting a bus, if you're getting a train regularly, your grocery shopping, you would be shocked by the price of cheese, people. It's very expensive. So it's something to consider if you're a cheese fan, making sure that you're budgeting for your cheese. With supermarket prices, unfortunately, being what they are at the moment, that's probably one of the things you'll have to consider the most if you've not already had any experience with that. speak to mum and dad, see if you can help out around the house, whether it's going with them to do the shop, maybe seeing if they'll let you do the shop independently. And then considering things like socialising in clubs as well. So obviously lots of people like to go out shopping and have a lovely dinner in the city. So just making sure that you're budgeting for a healthy balance of social life, because it's so important to have that social life, but balancing it alongside what's financial realistic for you. Oh, so here's a few of these examples that we have. So we have part-time work or student ambassadors. So those are the people you might see at open events as well, or offer holidays. Discount cards. So student discount is one of the biggest things that lots of places do. There's things like uni days, student beans, pooling resources. So if you and your flatmates want to club together and buy in for something for the flat, you can absolutely do that. And then there's things like student bank accounts as well. So student bank accounts are something that you can get when you're a student. And essentially what they are is they usually got different rules in terms of things like overdraft and interest. So having a look at what an overdraft is, so that is essentially if you go into an overdraft, that means that you have withdrawn more money than you have. So having a look at if they have one, if that's something that you want to take on as a responsibility, because it's absolutely a responsibility, and to see if it's interest free. So for example, an interest free overdraft, if you go into your overdraft by £100 and you don't pay it back for 4 months, but it's interest free, you will only still have to pay back that £100 you went over. Now that is something that might be worth considering as a backup should you ever need it. But like I say, it's not going to work for everybody. So just make sure that you sit down and have that discussion with someone who can talk to you a bit more about bank accounts. They also offer discounts. So they might be discounted on travel, discounted on gadgets. They will have different perks and benefits that work for each person. So many, many moons ago, nearly a decade ago, Santander, when I joined, were doing a discounted rail card for 4 years. So I actually saved a third on my train fees while I was at university for 3 years and then got an extra year afterwards. But like I said, that was a little while ago. But having a look at these different things is really, really important to check out. And like I keep saying, those scholarships and bursaries, have a look at them and see if you might be eligible. It's really worth checking out. Now, results day in August. So hopefully the weather will be good for a start, because that would be very nice. There are different ways it can go. So number one, you meet your entry requirements, your firm choice accepts you and you go to university. Option two is you don't meet your requirements for your firm choice and you drop to an insurance choice or go through clearing. Option three is you exceed entry requirements and you may like to consider another university. So that would also interestingly be going through clearing, but obviously for a different reason. And again, with that, there is still no guarantee that you will necessarily get the university of your choice, so it's something to consider. And then option four is if you've not previously applied, but you've surprised yourself and maybe had a thought over the summer that you would like to go to university, apply through clearing. It is open. It doesn't close on results day. So it's definitely something to think about if you've not already thought about it. Now, tips before you start. We will contact you with a welcome pack. Your accommodational allocation will be made as well, so just confirm your choice when you receive it and then pop your deposit down. If you have a reading list that is required, we will also let you know. And then enrollment as well. So enrollment's really important. It's a great time to come down and meet the university staff and get another feel for your classmates or your peers who will be in your graduation class in a few years' time. Always helps bringing chocolates for moving day too. My mum sent me with tea bags because people make friends when you drink PG tips, apparently. Now, Freshers Week activities. There will be a variety of things going on. It is a fun week and we have lots of different things planned. This will be a great opportunity to have a look at the different social life that you could be experiencing over the next year. So have a look at these activities that are available, check out different social media pages that we'll be running different activities with. So you might find that some societies set up their own. So if you know you're interested in, say, the American football team, it would be really cool to check out their social media before you get to us, so you can have a look. Our cheerleading team is on TikTok as well, so you can check out all of the different things that will be available for you. And then obviously you'll receive the great big start date as well. So that is when your future will really, really start too. Now, I'm just going to touch a little bit on clearing. It actually opens before your results day. It opens in summer, so this year it's going to be the 5th of July. And it impacts most students on results day in August, obviously, when you all really receive your results. You can self-release into clearing. So that's when we're talking about if you decide to maybe try for another university, whether you've gone for something a little bit higher than you were expected or the other way around, that is where you can self-release into clearing. Visit the institutions before making your choice again, and don't forget to ask about accommodation. It closes in October, so stay calm and make sure that you're just making the best decision for you, because at the end of the day, that is the most important thing, is making sure that you're going to be comfortable and happy at your university choice. Now, we do have some open days. If you've not already been to have a look around, please do. So our next one is actually in July on the 7th. And then we've got one the next day as well, so you could come down on Saturday, and then another one in September. We also have our offer holder days that I've mentioned. So if you are an offer holder from us and you haven't received your invite yet, please feel free to give us a ring and we can have a look at when your next offer holder day is. And come on down and have a look at different ones that we've got as well. So they are a great opportunity, like I said, to have a bit of a sample workshop or activity in your different course choices. And we also have our social media. So this is our inquiries email here. And then this is an important phone number. If you want to write that down, please do. I'll leave it up, actually. And please give us a ring or an email if there's anything you're ever in doubt about. Just ask us. We would rather you weren't sat there worrying about it, bless you. Please give us a shout, give us an email. Be more than happy to help. We've got our social medias, so have us check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, like I said, cheerleading teams on TikTok, LinkedIn as well. Loads of different opportunities to have a look at what we're doing. Now, I will actually just leave this up for you here, as it is the end of the presentation. And if anyone did have any questions for me, I will do my best to answer them.
Thank you very much indeed. That's just been so comprehensive. And whilst we know that all of the students and parents online will perhaps be interested in Lincoln and excited by Lincoln, there will be some who will be obviously looking at other universities. But so much of what you've said applies to, you know, across the board to the application process and the next steps. But we would encourage students who are online from year 12 and any parents to go and visit the University of Lincoln, or even consider it as a place to do a master's after your university if you're going elsewhere. It is a great campus and university, and has a huge range of courses, so we would encourage students very much indeed to go. What I would say is Faye's been putting lots of information links in the chat as Beth's been talking, and I've got a few questions whilst we're waiting for anyone to type in. So can I just run those by you, Beth, whilst we're waiting to see if there are any questions?
Yeah, absolutely. Please fire away.
Lovely. Thank you. Certainly, when you talked about a bank account, that's a really interesting thing. One of the places that we sometimes recommend, and it's just one of those sources, is something like Martin's Money Tips, or somewhere to go and have a look at a range of bank accounts that might be available with any particular advantages. Is there anywhere else that you might recommend for students to go and have a look at?
Yep, so if you already bank with a certain bank and you're considering of just staying with them, checking out the individual bank's website is a great one. There are also lots of student-centered websites like the Student Room, Money Saving Expert, which.co.uk, even Save the Student. They actually list the best bank accounts of 2023, and they list all sorts of different information, like whether their overdraft is interest-free, what perks they might come with them, Like I say, I actually checked as well just while you were talking, and the Santander still offers a free rail card, even though it was 2016 when I first went to university, so quite a while ago. But checking out those websites is a really great way to get impartial advice on a variety of different banking details.
That's great. Thank you very much indeed. One of the other questions we had was about how long will I spend weekly at university? And I think it's a good question because contact time differs from university to university, depending on the way in which a course is delivered. But can you tell us a little bit about Lincoln, but also perhaps broadening that out, to for a wider experience?
Yeah, absolutely. So just as you mentioned yourself, it would depend on university to university. It would also depend on the course, whether you have quite a heavy work placement. So there are some courses, for example, something like midwifery and paramedics. One of our sports courses has over 200 hours of clinical sort of experience that they have to complete. So it obviously not 200 hours a week, nobody panic. But it will depend on what kind of course you're doing, whether it has a heavy placement. On average, you can expect to sort of undertake about 37 hours of study each week. And then that's supplementing that with independent study. So one of the biggest things at university is obviously a lot of independent motivated reading outside of your course or study notes as well. But on average, about 37 hours.
That's great. Thank you. And Faye and I were actually on a very interesting webinar yesterday, and this is something I'd like to highlight to students and parents, and perhaps you can shed some light on this as well, Beth. But obviously, in terms of widening participation, getting the most out of university, it's very important that students and parents talk to the universities that they've chosen about any extra support that they might need, whether that's actually for any kind of impairment, disability, but also in terms of any hardship or anything like that. And I think that's something that people are often reluctant to do, but it is really important because there is help and support available, isn't there, Beth?
Absolutely. So I was actually in some training this morning talking about our wellbeing services, and I was really impressed to see, even though I've been for a few months, I was never actually a student at the university. So I was really impressed to see and learn about all of the different support that we have. So we've got on-campus financial support if someone is struggling hardship and they've maybe not been able to budget. We can help provide budgeting workshops. There is also things that we can do to financially support students if they are in trouble at university. If it's a case of them, perhaps let's say we've not quite budgeted and we can't access food, we do have ways to link through food banks as well. And then in terms of sort of one of the more serious aspects, I suppose, in terms of well-being emotionally and physically, we have lots of different people who can help. So we have something called the Student Wellbeing Centre. It is also the site of our on-site doctor GP as well. So you can access a GP on site and they can help with a variety of things. So that could be anything from sort of misconduct, harassment, support, anything that you need to support through sort of those difficult procedures, all the way through to helping undiagnosed learning difficulties, helping you get those sorted or supported with, and then also lots of mental health support as well. And if we have a variety of staff actually who work in that sort of area who have had lots of variety experiences, everything from psychiatric wards at the NHS all the way through to people working in social areas. So they are people who have seen and possibly heard absolutely everything and are so ready and welcoming and ready to support students. It's actually a really great resource that we have. We also alter the service depending on the demand. So a few years ago, pre-COVID, people preferred appointments. And now actually we found that a lot more people prefer to just walk in and be seen immediately when they need that support. So we have actually altered the way we run the service for the demand of the students as well.
That's really helpful. And I think that's mirrored in universities across the country to a different degree. But, you know, I think it's really important that parents and students are reassured that those services are available and that they should be able to go and talk to the right people, because obviously it's a very big step. And for some people, it's a particularly difficult step and it's important to ask for that support. I think I made a couple of notes as well about things like the part-time work, the ambassadors. Again, lots of universities offer work on either campus or within the university sort of establishment in different support teams. And I think it's a really good idea for students to engage in those kind of roles if they feel that that's something that they would like to get out of their student experience. And I think it's actually important for students and parents to consider what kind of experience they want out of the university kind of time that they have, not just their academic, but what they're looking for in terms of their 3 or 4 years commitment to gain from it. And I think things like becoming an ambassador, maybe taking a year, a placement year, getting involved in charitable events, all of those things add to a life experience, not just the academic. And I think it's really important, and I'm sure you'd agree, Beth, that students take advantage of that.
Absolutely. I think it's really, really great. It gives you the chance to obviously, and it does help to earn some money on the side, but it also gives you the opportunity to experience maybe more about how the university campus is run actually as well. So yeah. When our students get involved in our open days, they're there to set up all of the different stalls that we need, making sure that we've got the correct equipment. So when you come to us, you will receive lots of different information. So making sure that we've got enough for everybody to go around. A lot of the time they run tours as well. And then when they're working on sort of more closed events, so for example, we've got recruitment ambassadors who work very closely with my team and myself, and they help us if we have an on-site school visit. So we could have anywhere from year 6 up to year 13. And what they will help us do is they can help tour our students as well. So they work quite closely with a variety of age ranges. They can help them answer questions. They sometimes run sessions as well. So student life talks, they talk about their experiences and how that works for them. And they can also help on a more sort of peer-to-peer level, talk to people in a way that makes sense to them. And then things like societies and different clubs, charity events, even running for things like presidents and members of our SU team, there are loads of different opportunities to raise money, to campaign, try something new. As well, so it's definitely one of those ones that I highly encourage, because although obviously you're here to study for a degree, university is so much about finding yourself and experiencing that social balance as well. It's really important.
That's excellent, thank you, and I think that's encapsulated exactly what I was hoping for. Thank you, Beth. We haven't had any questions actually in the chat, so I will just wrap up by saying that we will be obviously issuing this recording to parents and students. We'll put that on our YouTube channel, and again University of Lincoln will be visiting us at our HE fair in October for the current year 12s. If there are any of you online here tonight, you will be able to see representatives from the University of Lincoln, as there will be a range of universities in October at the HE Fair. What I would like to say is that we are very grateful to Beth this evening for exploring those next steps. If any students or parents have any questions, please do direct those to careers@keds.ac.uk, which Faye has just put in the chat. We're always available as well in our new careers hub on Coventry Street if students would like to pop in and have any concerns or questions. Jane Edwards, UCAS coordinator, is also located within the Careers Hub on Coventry Street with Faye and myself as careers advisors. Parents, please do, by all means, email into careers@ if you have any queries. And we will be having more speaker series as the remainder of this year goes through, and of course into next year for year 12s too. Beth, thank you very much indeed for joining us this evening, and thank you to students and parents. We hope you've benefited from all of the information you've received, And we will be also circulating the presentation together with the video that we know wouldn't work at the time, but we'll be recirculating that along with the video of this presentation. So thank you to you all this evening. I hope you have a very good rest of the evening and see you again on our next speaker series. Thank you all. Bye-bye.